Good afternoon. Welcome to Rethinking Open Society. I'm Michael Ignatieff, Rector and President of Central European University. And the distinguished gentleman over here is Ivan Krastev from IWM in Vienna, runs a liberal think tank in Bulgaria. He is a member of the Open Society Foundation Global Board. He is a frequent columnist in the New York Times, commenting on European issues. And he's not to blame for this, but he's my friend. There we go. And we are continuing our discussion about open society. And in this discussion, we're going to be focusing on the extremely important relationship between the domestic politics of particularly states in Eastern Europe and Europe, and why electorates are taking certain positions on Europe, why domestic political systems are taking particular positions on Europe. That dynamic will be at the center of our discussions today. We have a wonderful, wonderful title because Ivan has an excellent sense of humor. It's called Perhapsburg, which I'm sure will be the single word you remember best from the whole evening, has already been lodged in your brain. Perhapsburg, reflections on the fragility and resilience of Europe. There is some sense in which Europe as a vision is the paradigmatic open society project. That is the vision of a Europe that is united, whole, free, permitting the exchange of ideas, concepts, persons across borders, respectful of the national identities and political characteristics of each state, but allowing a interaction between peoples once at war that is as close to a utopia as anything generated since 1945. So I hope our discussion will not be about the boring mechanics of Europe, but lift it up towards what I think needs to be recovered in Europe, which is that it is a political vision connected to peace, connected to prosperity, connected to markets, but above all, connected to openness, openness of minds, openness of hearts, openness of exchange among people speaking different languages, different cultures, different religions, and different faiths. And I hope we recover that in our discussions, and that connects us to the open society theme. Let me also do my housekeeping first, because it is a bad habit of mine. I forget the housekeeping, and then people hiss at me too late to tell you what you really need to know, which is that after this event, at promptly 7 o'clock, there will be pogača and wine afterwards, just behind here. You go out and go to the left. And then, since you have been a faithful audience and been actively involved in this discussion, on March the 30th, we will have France's single most distinguished expert on the politics of Central and Eastern Europe, Jacques Rupnik. Jacques is trained at Harvard, teaches at Sciences Po, published everywhere on the subject of the politics and culture of Eastern Europe, and he will be here on the 30th of March. So I hope that you will write that in your diaries. I think I see someone doing that now, which is excellent, excellent. Without further ado, I turn over to Ivan. Ivan knows that this is an audience that has active questions to ask, and we will have microphones, and we'll circulate. We will have a brisk discussion. which will end promptly at 7 o'clock. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And now when I know that there are going to be wine after the lecture, I feel reassured. You're going to get something at the end. So first, thank you very much for the invitation, and I really see this as a privilege. What I'm going to talk to is very much based as a part of a book of mine, which is going to be published in May this year in English by the Penn University Press, and in June in German. And I wanted to have Perhapsburg in the title. And they said that it's too poetic to go. So they put it after Europe. Probably the book is not as pessimistic as the title, but Bulgarians can never be very much blamed for being highly optimistic. There was an opinion polls being done which shows that Bulgarians has the biggest kind of, we are much more unhappy than our GDP can suggest. So when the pessimist and the optimist basically disagrees, the glass half full or half empty, we are basically convinced it's half broken. So I'll start with this, and basically what I'll try to do is exactly to try to connect some of the problems that European Union faces today to some of the core problems which I do believe that very notion of open society is facing. So had I been cryogenically frozen in January 25, I would have gone to my provisional rest as a happy European. Timothy Gardanesh wrote some weeks ago. And he was right. Imagine January 2005, the idea of the return to Europe, basically the enlargement of the European Union. European Union then was perceived as a very successful convergence machine. For decades, the distance between the poorest and the richest members of the Union had been closing. There was a lot of soft power then. Everybody around the European Union wanted to join, and the major story was when this is going to happen. Plus, there was a very high level of optimism also on the level of societies. Free travel, there was the idea of prosperity going on. And then Tim Gartenesh continues saying, if I was unfrozen in 2017, I should have died from shock because everything around is crisis, everything is disintegration. So how to make a sense out of it is the first question that I want to pose. How to try to make sense of this crisis and how we should rethink the last 25 years in order to understand what is happening now. There is a beautiful novel by José Saramago, who, to be honest, I found one of the best way to try to understand what is going on, and it is called Death with Interruptions. And the plot of the novel is about a country in which suddenly people stop dying. Nobody died in January, nobody died in February, nobody died in March. People start to be highly excited. There was a total euphoria. Immortality was rich. And then after a certain period of time, certain practical and metaphysical problems started to appear. First were the insurance companies. If nobody is dying, the insurance company said, we are dead. We basically cannot continue paying to everybody. But then was the church. They said, listen, if nobody is dying, nobody is resurrecting. So also the church is not benefiting out of it. And then there were people who were taking care of a vault and sick people, and they understood that forever they're going to do this. So a kind of a smuggling chain was created in which people started to channel the old and sick to the neighboring country where people were still dying. And then basically at some point, at the end of the book, the prime minister goes to the king and said, Your Majesty, if we will not start dying, we do not have a future. Mm-hmm. I'm saying this because to a certain extent, part of the problem that European Union is facing today is that this is the dream that turned into a nightmare. This is exactly the thing that we loved most that appeared to be the one that we felt threatened by. And nothing symbolizes this best than the problem of the open borders. Being East Europeans, you go on the opinion polls that have been done for the 25th anniversary of 1989, and you're going to see that even in countries like Bulgaria, where people are not very happy with how the situation developed for the last 25 years, there is one thing that they see as a major advantage, and this was opening of the borders, the possibility for people to travel. But suddenly the open border stopped to mean that we East Europeans can go outside. It started to mean that others can come. And as a result of it, the same open borders that have been perceived as the major advantage started to be perceived as the major vulnerability of the European project. I'm saying this because I really do believe that if we're not going to understand that the migration and refugee crisis, and here I'm going to use them as synonymous nevertheless, that neither in legal nor in political terms it should be like this, challenges some of the major assumptions of the notion of open society, I do believe we're not going to be kind of a frank with ourselves. Why I'm saying this? If you're going to reread the end of history article of Fukuyama, you're going to be surprised that there is a lot of talk about free flowing of ideas, of goods and capitals. There is one word which you are not going to find in the article, and this is migration. Ideas are going to travel. Goods are going to travel. Capitals are going to travel. But it was not assumed that people are going to travel. And this was quite important because at some point, I do believe we start to realize that it's much more the traveling of people that is going to change and to reshape the world of tomorrow than simply basically the free flow of ideas or even institutions. I'm saying this, and here is the first argument that I want to discuss is, I want to argue that migration is going to be the 21st century revolution. But this is going to be not the revolution of a revolutionary parties, they're not going to be manifestos, they're not going to be revolutionary leaders, they're not going to be a blueprint. It's going to be the exit revolution of the individual who has realized three things. First, that if you want to change your life in one generation, better to change your country than to change your government with the hope that it's going to change your country. It's a quite rational assumption. Secondly, and I do believe this is one of the very important aspects of globalization which have been always discussed but has not been taken seriously, is people, globalization change the frame of comparisons. Let's give you one example. In 1980s, when the World Value Survey started with the Michigan University, famous Inglehart project, they discovered that there was no positive correlations between happiness and wealth. In 1980s, Nigerians were as happy as West Germans. 20 years later, this was not the case. Nigerians were as happy as their GDP is going to suggest. What has happened meanwhile? Simply Nigerians got televisions, and they can see how the West Germans live. They can see their schools. They can see their hospitals. So you are not comparing anymore, neither with the previous generation, nor with your immediate neighbor. You basically start to compare with those who are most advanced in the world. And the biggest single factor that determines how much money you're going to spend in your life is not your education, but a place in which you're born. There was this famous book called The Birth Right Lottery. And the most important is, to be lucky these days simply means to be born in a place like Germany or Canada. So from this point of view, we end up with a situation in which the individuals, because of new technology, because of the new mobility, can really, on the base of a single decision, there is no collective action problem, can try to change radically their life simply by moving. And nobody can stop it. Because like any type of a revolution, basically it is driven by the desire of the people to change their life. And here comes the problem of Europe. Because at the moment when migration is the revolution of the 21st century, Europe is becoming a major counter-revolutionary power. Because basically this is the place where people are coming. And I do believe that if we want really to understand the impact of the migration crisis, we should go beyond the legal and humanitarian talk about people coming and how much people are coming and how they're going to be integrated. We should try to see the migration crisis in three different aspects. One is this flow of people, which everybody was talking about, and some very interesting stuff has been written. But the other is migration of arguments. 1970s, European left is going to defend the position that some of the Indian villages have the right to resist development and the World Bank projects because they have the right to defend their way of life. 2017. some of the middle class conservatives, part of our society, say we also have the right to defend our way of life. So from this point of view, these same arguments, which was argument of the left, is becoming the argument of the right. And it's not by accident that it's not simply that arguments migrate, but the voters migrate. One of the major things that happened as the result of the refugee crisis, and it was, of course, being prepared much earlier, is the fact that we see a massive migration of the blue-collar voters from the left and center-left to the far right. If you see basically the results of Brexit, if you see the Austrian elections, particularly the second round of the Austrian elections, you're going to see that more than 85% of the blue-collar voters in Austria voted for the far right, which shows that after the end of the Marxism as the kind of a framing ideology for the working class is not internationalist. They're both economically protectionist and culturally protectionist. But this is putting in crisis the very identity of the European political system, which was very much organized around the class conflict and basically the conflict between the left and right as we knew them during the Cold War. I'm saying this because as a result of these changes and the new political identities, a new political force emerges in not only Europe, but you can see this in the United States, which to a great extent is shaping politics as we see it, and I'm going to call them the threatened majorities. You have ethnic and religious majorities which are panicking and feeling persecuted in the way minority normally feels. These are not the losers of today, but these are many people who perceive them as the losers of tomorrow. And from this point of view, one of the major characteristics of these groups is the unleashing of the demographic imagination. You're trying to imagine the world without you. And to be honest, for some of the small Central and East European countries, this is a real problem. Let's give you some Bulgarian statistics. I do believe now there are around 7.5 million people living in Bulgaria, or even less. 1.5 million, according to these statistics, has left the country for the last 25 years. According to the UN projections, in the next 30 years, Bulgaria is going to lose 27% of its population. So the idea of ethnic disappearance is becoming one of the major forces that shapes the imagination of the future. We are not dreaming the future anymore. We are fearing it. And if you see the message of the populist party, what they promise is to stop time. Stop it, they're not going to be future. It's going to be like it is now because you are afraid. And this is not only demographic fears, technological fears are also very much there. If you read basically some of the analysis, around 50% of the existing European jobs or go to the robots. So now people are facing, in a certain way, a choice, what you should fear more, the robots or the foreigners. And here, basically, they read, but all the time goes in this type of a fear. I'm saying this because this type of a threatened majorities, they perceive globalization as a permanent revolution, and they're becoming apocalyptic. From this point of view, it's a not conservative movement. It's a reactionary movement. And Mark Liller, who was speaking here, I do believe make this point very well in his last book. Because the problem with the reactionary movements is that you want to create a major break with the idea that something is going to radically change. You don't have a dream how it should be, but you really believe that only a radical change is going to stop this kind of insecurity and uncertainty. I'm saying this because with the threatened majorities comes two other very important changes in our political life. One is very much the erosion of any type of argumentative discourse in democracy, and I don't want to use this fake news story because there is something very fake about fake news. People are becoming very ahistorical when they have a problem. For example, they said, we discovered fake news, how erosive they are. Listen, people knew how erosive it is. During the war, spreading rumors was punished by death. So obviously, even before kind of new technologies, people knew that they could be very erosive and they can create a huge distrust. But the second, these conspiracy theories has existed always. And people like to believe it. And coming from the Balkans, for us, conspiracy theory always was a form of common sense. But what has changed, by the way, this is very important, because in conspiracy theory, we always believe that people are looking for the truth. But in fact, when it comes to power, they're looking for the secret. And this is why I have, and this is my old position, I'm very skeptical about this falling in love with transparency, because believe me, there is nothing more suspicious than government that tells it's transparent. It basically mobilizes the imagination to go beyond, which is very strong. But the difference is that conspiracy theory are the ideology in the age of mistrust. Let's give you one example. The strongest factor to predicate who is going to vote for the Law and Justice Party in Poland is not age, is not income, but this is basically belief that the tragic death of President Kaczynski and 100 more members of the Polish elite was not an accident, but it was assassination. And this assassination hypothesis is giving political identity to people. But unlike ideologies, which some of them were also conspiracy theories, but with promise, with the idea of the future, there is no future dimension. Paradoxically, in a politics where conspiracy theories are giving political identities, you cannot keep your leaders accountable. And because everybody basically is giving the negative example with Trump, I'm just going to give a negative example with Hillary Clinton. If you believe that the only reason Hillary Clinton lost the elections is the Russian hacking, then there is no reason to ask what was wrong in the campaign, was this the best candidate? So you have a high level of unaccountability going there, because conspiracy theory creates victims' identity. And paradoxically, the majorities became as the major victims. And from this point of view, these threatened majorities, they hate both the elites and the migrants, because for them, this is the conspiracy between the elites and the migrants that they want to destroy their way of life. So I'm saying this, and I do believe, at least for me, this was quite important, because my second argument is that we talk a lot about democracy and its relations with open society. One of the things that is going to happen is that open society was functioning on the assumption that democracy is a democratic institution, and democratic mechanisms are institutions that are allowing, including different social groups, different minorities in the political process. I'm going to say something which is very obvious, but it now I don't believe it's secret anymore. This same institution can be also the institutions of exclusion. Elections and others can, with the same way, easily exclude people in the way they're including people. So from this point of view, under certain conditions, democracy can be the way of opening societies. Democracy also could be the way of closing societies, and closing in a very legitimate way through the popular vote. So saying this, I'll move to the second part of my presentation, which is, I do believe that in order to understand part of the controversial nature of the EU crisis today, there's three paradoxes that probably we should address. And the first is, I'm going to call it the Central European paradox. If you're reading opinion polls, if it has not changed something dramatically in the last 1 month, and I'm reading a lot of opinion polls, so he's reading his mystery literature, and basically he's my detective. The two most pro-European societies in Europe were the Hungarians and the Poles. If this is the case, why they're voting for openly Eurosceptical governments? And second part of the Central European paradox is, why societies who are very mistrustful to politicians were not doing much to defend the separation of powers? Why you mistrust politicians, but you're ready to give to one politician or one party all the power there? How to explain this? It does not go so easily together. And here is at least my attempt to explain. First, I don't believe that in Eastern Europe we can talk about Euroscepticism in the way, for example, you can talk in the United Kingdom. Euroscepticism first believes that European Union is bad, but secondly, it assumes that if your country is outside of the European Union, you're going to do better. I know many East Europeans who are unhappy with many things in the European Union, and I do believe for legitimate reasons. I don't know many who believe that their country are going highly to prosper if they're going to leave. What you have in Eastern Europe is much more Euro-pessimism than Euroscepticism. The idea is, yes, probably it's okay, but it is not going to survive. And part of this Euro-pessimism is based on one major distinction between East European and West European. We in the East has the collapse of a political system in our personal experience. We have something that was very stable, and believe me, Bulgarian communism in the 1980s was very stable, almost like nature, it was not Poland. Collapsed overnight. And this type of fragility of everything political, I do believe, is creating this pessimistic view that, listen, we should hedge. Probably it's better for the European Union to survive, but you should behave in the way that if European Union is not going to survive, we're not going to be on the losing side. Paradoxically, this hedging is becoming one of the ways the European Union is weakening and paralyzed. Because don't forget, if European Union is going to collapse, it's not going to be because of the anti-EU revolution. It's not going to be because there are going to be more people in Europe who are against the Union than for the Union. If it's going to collapse, it's going to collapse like a run on a bank. Because you start to fear that it is going to collapse, you start to behave in the way to increase and basically to optimize your position when it is going to collapse. And I do believe this is an important part of understanding this strange behavior of otherwise pro-EU East Europeans who tolerate a very much EU unfriendly governments. But the second metaphor which I'm going to give you to understand some of the sensitivity of these populist governments that we are electing is that they have some of the characteristics of the second generation of migrants. The first generation is people like Havel and Michnik and many people that have been going through this university. For them, basically, the very integration in the European institutions and others was the definition of collective success. Because the truth is that for the last 25 years, we all emigrated from the East to the West. Some do it individually, others collectively with their countries. But what is typical for the second generation is that nevertheless, that in a certain way, they're much more integrated than the first one. They start to experience very painfully the limits of integration. Ceiling glasses, this feeling that you're second class of a citizen, and so on and so on. And I can see this very much in some of these governments, which are very different otherwise. The second paradox that I want to present you so we can discuss is, okay, Central European paradox is fine, but why the separation of power is not something that people are ready to defend? And also, why people are not ready to defend neutral institutions like media, central bank, courts? And here's my hypothesis, which you can agree and disagree, but from the liberal point of view, and particularly from the point of view of somebody who is trying to make a theory of open society, the separation of power is the best way to keep elites accountable. But for many people on the street, the separation of power is the way how elites are avoiding accountability. You go to your government, and the government said, listen, don't blame me. I cannot do it because the courts are not allowing me. I cannot change economic policy because the central bank is not allowing me. And when it goes for a long period of time, people start to suspect that instead of controlling elites, the separation of power is becoming a trick of the elites to do what they want to do. And as a result of it, you have this strange situation in which people mistrust their political leaders, they believe that they're corrupt, they do believe that they're incompetent, but they said the only way to keep him accountable is to give him a lot of power so he cannot excuse what he's doing or not doing. And I do believe that this logic is quite important, not to answer why governments are trying to dismantle check and balances. Why they are trying to dismantle check and balances is quite obvious. Why people who benefit theoretically from check and balances are not ready to defend it. So the second paradox, the West European paradox, is a different one. If you go, let's go with the Brexit vote, you're going to see that age and education made a major difference between the Remainers and the Exiteers. And also after 2008, you can see the younger generation have been much more politicized than before. You have a lot of protest. Many of the people on the street have been young people. Why the political impact of these people, who theoretically are much more pro-European, didn't do much to increase the chances of the European Union to survive? Why otherwise movements who are composed of the pro-European youth did not strengthen the EU? And there are many explanations, by the way, one of them being that youth is becoming minorities in most of our societies. not simply the voting minority, but simply the minority. We have a reverse age structure. But there is also something very typical for these movements. And this is that this is the movements who are also composed of a young, quite empowered people, very much empowered also by the new technologies and by the fact that they can make a difference. And for making a difference, they don't need organizations. It's very strong anti-institutional ethos. You remember the idea of the horizontal networks. You remember the idea of the leaderless protest and leaderless revolution. But here is a paradox which a colleague of mine, a Turkish scholar at MIT, very nicely depicted. She gave a comparison which I love. She said, have you noticed that recently much more people are dying trying to climb Everest? Much more than ever before, people are, why? And the reason is because of the new technology, because of the new equipment, because of all these kind of things that make it easier to climb, people believe that Everest is going to be the first top that they can climb in their life. You're studying in the CEU and then you go to Everest. But it's not so easy. There is some problem with the air. There are certain type of skills. Normally before, the social movements were so difficult to organize that you are not going to end up with hungry thousand on the street through the social media. You're going to end up with 5,000, which after that can become 10,000, and they're going to be this organizational experience, this maturing, which is allowing these movements to become politically possible. Paradoxically, this same instrument that is empowering people weakens them. The very fact that you can get 200 people just through the Facebook to enter on the street make it much more difficult to create a political organization that stands and that can move. And I do believe that this paradox of empowered individual who is so empowered that basically believes that he can ignore the need for collective action, the need of representation, is one of the answers why we have a powerless youth which otherwise is pro-European and otherwise is politically active. Because if you do not believe in political representation, you cannot be part of the European conversation. European Union cannot exist as a union of a direct democracy. It's too big, two different languages. Probably direct democracy is good, but not for the EU of 500 million. As a result of it, the major mistrust to political representation makes these movements, even when they're quite effective on a local level, or even on the national level, quite ineffective basically on the European level. And here's the paradox, because also I see Jordi, the two countries in which political parties born out of these movements were quite successful was Podemos in Spain and Syriza in Greece. What is typical for these two parties is that in their structure, this is one of the most traditionally organized parties in Europe. Podemos, which before the idea was leaderless movement, leaderless party, on the first elections, on the bulletin, they have the face of their leader. Syriza is much more close to a good old-fashioned kind of a leftist party than anything that comes from the horizontal networks. So from this point of view, the paradox of the younger generation is that their mistrust in organizations weakened their possibility to make a change. And now I'm moving to my last paradox. And this is the paradox which probably is going to be closer to the heart of some of you. And this is based on the following. If you go to the European elite, and particularly I'm talking about the top bureaucracy in Brussels, this is the most meritocratic elites that normally we have. People who made their career through good education, I'm calling them the exam passing elites. They do it the fair way. They have been competing, they took the exams and the next exams. It's not a corrupt elite, honestly speaking. Probably it's a Bulgarian perspective, but yeah, from certain things that I know that Hungary is a totally different place, but this is a relatively clean elites. But they quite resent it, and here's my question. Why parents who are going to give all their money to send their kids to the best universities do not want to be governed by people who graduate these universities? And from this point of view, I do believe Mr. Trump is an interesting example. There was one thing that President Trump was, probably outside of many other, was hiding about his biography. And this is that he had a very good education, in fact. He graduated Wharton Business School, very well-known place. He was talking about everything, about his money and so on, but he never allowed people to understand that he graduated one of the big business schools in the United States. Because part of the resentment and mistrust is not against the rich, but against the people who made their money based on their good university and the networks that come there. And I was trying to understand what is so problematic about the meritocratic elites. And if you're going to read Michael Young's book on meritocracy, which is now almost 50 years old, you're going to see that we could have expected this. Because meritocratic society makes very clear the distinction between winners and losers. And exactly because of the fact that the winners have the feeling that they did it the fair way and the right way, they don't have much sympathy for the losers. There were exams, you did the exams, I didn't do the exams. Why you should have compassion for me? I have my chance. As a result of it, you have the elites which are not really, we have this paradox of inclusive elites which leads to quite exclusive society. Universities are becoming much more inclusive, but exactly because in your class you're going to see minorities, you're going to see people coming from a humble background, you're losing a sympathy and compassion for those who didn't make it. Rawls believed that it's better to be a loser in a fair society than unfair society. And it's a very strong philosophical argument, but I do believe that he didn't live very actively in his own neighborhood, because there is nothing more depressing than being a loser in a fair society. Because if you're a loser in unfair society, you always can blame the system. But if you're basically a loser in fair society, you should blame yourself. And blaming yourself is not very popular, and I understand it perfectly why. So I'm saying this because the very mobility of the elites, something that is so important from the way they have their identity and they're so proud with, became one of the major important sources of resentment. And this is why using the Hirschman distinctions between exit and voice, seen from the point of view of the populist voter, the clash between the populists and the elites is the clash between the exit party, the elites, which can always can leave. You can teach in Budapest, but you can teach also in London. You can teach in Buenos Aires. You can go anywhere. And people that have nowhere to go. And the major message of the populist elites are, yeah, we are probably corrupt and we are probably incompetent, but we are going to stay with you till the end because we have nowhere to go. We don't speak foreign languages. We don't have international networks. And you know, this is a quite important message, unfortunately. And if 50 years ago, the major change about how the world is going to be changed was about nationalization of assets, factories, and others. Now the major message is nationalization of the elites. And nationalization of the elites is what many of these political parties and leaders are doing. Because for them, the elites are perceived, these cosmopolitan meritocratic elites, as offshore elites. So after making this very optimistic views, how pessimistic we should be about the European Union, and here comes my last 2-3 minutes. Of a kind of a contrarian optimism. First, Machiavelli used to say that people should never surrender for the simple reasons that they don't know what the fortune has prepared for them. And I do believe this is very wise, because in the way we are surprised all the time, we can be also surprised for good. And from this point of view, I want to make a major distinction between the year 2016 and 2017. The major shock of 2016 was not simply that Brexit happened or that President Trump was elected, but very few who didn't vote for them expected this to happen. As a result of it, there was the shock that you don't understand anymore the world in which you are living, and this created a level of depression, which was not simply the depression that something bad happened, but you have the feeling that you're out of touch, that you are vulnerable because you don't understand anything anymore. The paradox of 2017 is that 2016 was so depressing that now people expect only negative things to happen. If you read papers, Now, people are sure that Wilders is going to be the new prime minister of Netherlands. The president of France is going to be called Marie Le Pen. And alternative for Germany probably can enter the government in Germany. All this could happen, and particularly France's situation, I find it very unpredictable. But on the other side, most probably it will not happen. Wilders can win the elections, but probably he's not going to enter the government. And if something really bad did not happen in France, Marie Le Pen probably is going to be first on the first round, but still the chances to win the second round lower than to the other candidate. And in Germany, even if Schulz is going to be elected, this is not the end of the German political consensus. I'm saying this because I do believe the very survival of any political project is one of the major sources of legitimacy. We basically trust things not simply because they're good or bad, but because they survive. And this kind of a power of survival, look at the Habsburg Empire now, because of course you can imagine Perhapsburg was very much referenced to there. And all people are now reading carefully books about how the empire collapsed in 1918. But the interesting question about the Habsburg Empire is why it did not collapse in the previous 100 years, where it had to collapse. 1848, it was already collapsed. And then you have all this. So from this point of view, I'm not a great friend of this political determinism, which till yesterday was claiming that everything is bright, and now it's claiming that everything is dark. Life has the pleasure to surprise us. And here is my last point. Even we don't know if European Union is going to be saved, who's going to save it. There is a beautiful book, which personally I very much like. It's called Anatomy of a Moment. And it takes the story of the famous failed 1981 coup in Spain. So Franco is dead, the transition starts, and 1981, some lieutenant with his soldiers of the National Guard enters the parliament and decides to put the end of Spanish democracy. People were not on the streets to protect democracy. Probably they didn't have time, but they have been also tired. They have been exhausted. The king, of course, played a very important role and for the coup to fail. But there was something important that psychologically changed the dynamics, and it happened in the parliament. When, and this is, by the way, recorded on the film, because the plotters forgot for 40 minutes to stop the camera working. When the soldiers entered and asked all members of parliament to go on the floor, 3 persons didn't go. 3 persons stayed. And this was the 3 most unlikely persons to stay in defense of democracy. First was Prime Minister Suarez, Franco functionary, who made all his career during the Franco period, and he was famous for compromise and not for heroism. The other was the Minister of Defense, Franquista general, that made his career fighting the Republic. And the third was the leader of the Communist Party of Spain, which for years was claiming that basically bourgeois democracy is a sham. But this stayed, and because it stayed, the coup plotters were totally frustrated. They don't know they lost the initiative. So probably we can expect also that from some unexpected sources, the resilience of Europe is going to come. So thank you very much for your patience.